Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In the name of Allah, most kind and most merciful. We have a very important topic for discussion today, and that is the monument known as the Doom of the Rock, which is the second most important on the holy place in Jerusalem. That is the main platform where the Masjid al-Aqsa is standing. And that is our topic today, and I will try to cover whatever aspects I know about this most important place of Islam. And I do not claim that the information I give you, that is the total information about this site, about the relationship of the site with the rest of the history of that most important event that is known as Al-Isra or the Mi'raj. But nevertheless, whatever I know from the architectural point of view, or the related to architectural point of view, I will be telling you in this discourse. So the story of our today's lecture starts with the Surah Al-Isra. Or then if you look at this Surah Al-Isra, otherwise it is also known as Surah Bani Israel. So then in this we have a reference to Masjid Al-Haram and also the Masjid Al-Aqsa. That means the two most important places which are referred with the incident of Mi'raj Sharif. One is the Masjid Al-Haram and the second is the Masjid Al-Aqsa. The Dome of the Rock is this building, which is the golden dome which you see, and the old city of Jerusalem all scattered around it. And this is a very, very old picture. Now the history of the Dome of the Rock, goes like this, that the Dome of the Rock is an Islamic shrine located on the Temple Mount. This platform, which is described by a white line, is known as the Sacred Mount or the Temple Mount in the old city of Jerusalem. It was initially completed in 691-92 at the order of Umayyad Caliph Abdul Malik bin Marwan. So I think this Umayyad Caliph has contributed a lot toward the construction of the not only the Mosque of Al-Aqsa, but also many other monuments on the site, including the building of the Dome of the Rock. The rock over which the shrine was built is sacred to both Muslims as well as to the Jews. The Prophet Muhammad, the founder of Islam, is traditionally believed to have ascended into heavens from this site. So that is the importance of this site, that the Prophet came to this place, and then from this place he was taken to the heavens by the Hazrat Jibreel, alayhi salam. So that is the most important event associated with the travel, which is known as Al-Isra. Beside the famous rock, the interior of the dome is lavishly decorated with mosaics, faience and marble, much of which was added several centuries after its completion. It also contains the Quranic inscriptions. So in this way, this is a unique building. It has frescoes and it has faience work and it has marble work and it has columns which are almost monolithic, and they are also made of granite. There is, then if you look at the mosaics, they are of various types, and when I say they are of various types, we see that in them there is various kinds of balances, and we know quite a few type of balances which we use in normally in the art of drawing or composition, but toward the end of this lecture I will explain number of balances which have been used in the construction of these mosaics in the Dome of the Rock. Two names of its architects are mentioned in history books. One of the architects is known Raja ibn Ahawa, and the second is the Yazid ibn Salam. When I say Raja, this is the Raja, as you in Hindi or Sanskrit, it is actually Raja. Re, Jim, and An, Raja ibn Ahawa, and the Yazid ibn Salam. But the Christian, on the other hand, claim that the basic design of this building had been stolen from some of the Roman temples. But that's not true. The whole construction, and if you look at the geometry of this building, it is nowhere near any monument of the Romans or any monument of the Christians. So we should not be distracted or confused about this claim of the Christianity. Actually, the people who are known as the Orientalists, and the Orientalists were those people who were living in the West, where they were talking about the Orient or the East. And these Orientalists have been writing a lot about Islam and other religion of the East. And in most cases, their stance has been anti-Islam. For example, when the Muslims wanted to create a university in Aligarh, they were not allowed to call it an Islamic university, but they insisted it should be called a Mohammedan university. Because they claimed that if Christianity is after Christ, the religion of Islam is not Islam, it is Mohammedanism. So its name Mohammedan University ho gaya. So phir baad mein bade der baad change hua. So they had taken stances like this against Islam, and there was an author by the name of H.B. Havell. He wrote books on Islamic architecture in India, because he was also once upon a time principal of J.J. School of Arts in Bombay. So he says that Islamic architecture is not anything. It is an offshoot of Hindu architecture in India. So he goes here. And then he criticizes Islam to the extent that he says that this is a mazhab. Even the we will die, or the Muslim will die in paradise, the men will get hoofs and the females will get nothing. So this kind of arguments he takes against Islam. But that is the kind of propaganda or the prejudice which we come across while we're studying the history written by the Orientalists. So we have to debate these things, and we have to go into conflict and try to point our point of view. Now in Surah 17 Al-Isra, verse 1 of the Holy Quran, a clear reference is made to the Prophet's right journey to highest heavens. This surah is also called Surah Ben Israel. But this name is a merely distinctive appellation, like the name of many other surahs, and not a descriptive title. And does that mean that the Bani Israel is the theme of this surah? And that's very correct. If you go through whole of the surah, and then there's not much about the Bani Israel. Likewise, there are many other surahs. Jaise Surah Al-Rum, to usme padte jaye to Rum ka to koi zikr hi nahi aata. It is known as Surah Al-Rum. So sometimes it is just the appellation, that's sometimes just the name or the importance of the name that is related or kept as the title of the surah. But the actual name of the surah is Bani Isra. Kuch log isse Isra se bhi kehte hain, this is a shortened form of Israel, which is not correct. Isra simply means a culmination or a journey to the heavens, otherwise known as Al-Miraj. Now this is the passage of the journey. It starts from the Mecca and we go to Medina from here, and then from Medina we go to the Mount Sinai, where Allah spoke to Musa alayhi salam. And from here we go to another place where Prophet also made prayers, at this place, that is the birthplace where Isa was born. This is known as the Bethlehem. And then from the Bethlehem to the grave of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, and which is outside the Masjid Al-Aqsa. And then from there, the journey to the tomb of the rock, and then upward to the heavens. So this is the journey, starting from this place, that is Mecca, and going up to the heavens. Long journey, but nevertheless took place within a few fraction of a second. So Al-Isra, the event took place on the 27th of Rajab, according to the Islamic calendar. This the Surah Al-Isra I already quoted to you in the beginning of today's presentation. And the translation goes like this: the glory be to one who took his servant, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by night from Al-Masjid Al-Haram in Mecca to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Al-Quds, whose surroundings we have blessed, to show him some of our signs. Indeed, he is the all-hearing and all-seeing, from the same Surah Al-Isra. the very first verse of Surah Al-Isra indicates that this surah was revealed on the occasion of Miraj or Ascension. According to the traditions and books on the life of the Holy Prophet, known as the Seerah, this event happened 1 year before Hijrah. Thus, the surah is one of those which were revealed in the last stages of prophethood in Mecca. So that is the actual time of the travel. Many of us know the basic story of Al-Isra wal-Miraj, that the Prophet was transported from Masjid Al-Haram to Masjid Al-Aqsa, from where he ascended to heaven. In fact, there were many stops along this incredible journey, and the story is packed with wonders and miracles. Normally, when we are looking at this event, to hum yehi kehte hain ji woh wahan se journey shuru hua phir woh aasman pe chale gaye, and then we start talking about what happened at Islam, at the heavens. Uska bhi kuch pata nahi hai exactly kya hua wahan, but nevertheless, what happened in between, nobody telling us. But if we dig out the story, or the story related to the Al-Isra Al-Miraj, so hume pata chalta hai ki in between, according to the historians who wrote the hadith, they narrate quite a few important events. For example, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sleeping in Mecca, he said, "The roof of my house was opened, and the angel Jibreel descended." This is quoted by Al-Bukhari. Scholars are reconciling between various narrations say the Prophet was then taken to the Hijr, the semicircular wall of the Kaaba, जिसको हम आजकल हदीन कहते हैं. तो सबसे पहले जिब्राइल ने आपको उठाया और आपको उठा के उस जगह पे ले गए जो काबा की बिल्डिंग और हतीम के दरमियान है. Where the Prophet said that Jibreel opened my chest and washed it with Zamzam water. Then he brought a golden tray full of wisdom and faith, and having poured its contents into my chest, he closed it. This is also quoted by Al-Bukhari. So that is the another aspect of this story, a very important aspect of this story. The Prophet continues, the Prophet continues to narrate what happened after that. I was then brought a white beast, which is called Al-Burak, from the Arabic word Burk, meaning lightning, bigger than a donkey. This animal was bigger than a donkey, according to the Prophet, and smaller than a mule. Its stride was as long as the eye could reach. मतलब वो जो घोड़ा नुमा चीज थी जिसका साइज एक गधे से थोड़ा बड़ा और खच्चर से थोड़ा छोटा था, वो उसकी एक जंप जो थी इतनी बड़ी थी कि एक जगह से दूसरी जगह नजर वहां तक नहीं पहुंचती थी. The way they had the power to jump in the air or in the space. So that is what is narrated by a Muslim while he is quoting Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But that Burak is painted in a very different way in our society. The Burak, when we say it's Burk, and Burk is primarily spoken as a female. तो उस फीमेल से हमने बुराक को एक लड़की की सूरत में बना दिया. हमारे आर्टिस्टों ने, द पीपल हु ट्राई टू विजुअलाइज व्हाट काइंड ऑफ बुराक वाज एंड व्हाट काइंड ऑफ एनिमल इट वाज. तो अगर आप देखें ट्रकों के पीछे और गाड़ियों के पीछे और दूसरी चीज़ों के रिक्शाओं के पीछे, तो बुराक इज लाइक ए फ्लाइंग हॉर्स विद द हेड ऑफ ए फीमेल. तो इन इंडिया दैट फ्लाइंग हॉर्स बीन ट्रांसलेटेड इनटू ए काऊ आल्सो एज यू सी इन दिस पिक्चर. तो आर्टिस्टों का तो जैसे दिल करता है बना देते हैं, बट द थिंग व्हिच वी वेयर वी कम अक्रॉस एन एनालॉजी इज दिस दैट व्हाइल दिस एनिमल इज डिस्क्राइब्ड एज अ फीमेल. तो अब हम जहाँ भी कोई इवेंट इम्पोर्टेंट इवेंट होता है हमारी लाइफ में, तो दैट फीमेल हॉर्स इज वेरी वेरी familiar thing. जैसे on the events of the शादी के इवेंट में जो आपका घोड़ा आता है जिस पर दूल्हा सब ट्रैवल करता है, कभी अब तो नहीं करता, बट इन 50-60 years ago or 100 years ago the bridegroom was always riding a horse, and that was a female horse, that was not a horse but a mare. तो घोड़ी का जो कॉन्सेप्ट है वो बड़ा स्ट्रॉन्ग कॉन्सेप्ट रहा फॉर वेरी वेरी लॉन्ग टाइम, 200-300 years के लिए. The घोड़ी was the most important thing in the case of the शादीज. तो उसी से बड़ा एक मशहूर गाना मुझे आज तक याद है, वीर मेरा घोड़ी चढ़िया. कभी वीर घोड़े पे नहीं चढ़ता, आई डोंट नो व्हाई, बट दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एनालॉजी व्हिच वी सी इन आवर हिस्ट्री और इन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ आवर आर्ट्स. इट इज नरेटेड बाय अनस दैट बुराक वाज सैडल्ड एंड रेन, बट ही शाइड फ्रॉम हिम, दैट इज घोड़ा जो था वो हजरत मोहम्मद से शर्मा रहा था. So Jibril said to him, it is from Muhammad that you do this. Kya tum unki wajah se sharma rahe ho? But nobody has written you. Who is more honorable to Allah than him? He said, Jibril ne usko kaha ke to bada tumhari honor ki baat hai ki tum tumhare upar ye sawari karenge. So the ghoda was so perplexed with so much under the awe of the Prophet's personality. Kehte hain ki us ghode ko ya that burak was sweating severely. Itna us pe wo ek kisam ka khauf tari ho gaya. And in this picture, you see that the animal and also the Prophet riding on it, and the Jibril here, and the other angels surrounding the Prophet. These pictures, which I will show you from time to time, they have been taken from various copies of Miraj-nama. Miraj-nama is not just one book. Miraj-nama has been written in many languages, even in Persian and Arabic and other languages. And in every book or every volume of that Miraj-nama, there are a number of miniatures also. So this selection is from various books on Miraj-nama. At several points along the journey, Jibril stopped Burak and told the Prophet, dismount and pray. He told Prophet, Hazrat Muhammad ne kaha ki aap utre, and you pray at this stop. The first stop was at the place of immigration, i.e. Medina. The second stop was at Mount Sinai, where Allah revealed the Torah to Musa. The third stop was the Bethlehem, where Hazrat Isa was born. So these stoppages, this is a brief description of the stoppages in the beginning of this long, long journey. Once again, this is the map of the long journey, and these are the places where Prophet was asked to stop and pray at these places. The fourth stop was the grave of Musa al-Islam. So Prophet keh rahe hain ki I happened to pass by Musa's on the night of my night journey. Whilst he was standing praying in his grave, Hazrat Muhammad ne dekha ki Hazrat Musa to apni kabar mein khade hain aur namaz pad rahe hain. We know that this grave is located at a stone's throw away from the Blessed Masjid al-Haram. This incident clearly shows us an example of what the Messenger of Allah said about the Prophets, that after they pass away, the Prophets are alive in their graves praying. So this is a concept which strongly believed that jitne bhi paigambar hum Hazrat Muhammad se pehle aaye wo tamam ke tamam zinda hain apni qabron mein aur wo musalsal ibadat mein mashghool hain, and one of the most important event of the ibadat is that they are praying the salat in their graves. That means they are standing up and offering the zakat in the graves. Then arrival at Al-Aqsa. Finally, the Messenger of Allah arrived in the holy city of Al-Aqsa, and he said, when we reach Baitul Maqdis, Jibril pointed with his finger, causing a crack in the rock, and he tied the burak to it at the western wall of the noble sanctuary. It is quoted by Tirmidhi. Waiting inside were 124,000 prophets. Jibril led the prophet to the front, and he led them all in prayers in this blessed space. So yeah, event here, this is a little confusion about this event. Some say, or some historian or some expert on hadith say, the Prophet conducted these prayers as Imam of 124,000 prophets before him in Masjid al-Aqsa. Some other historian claim that the Prophet was standing on a rock, and at that rock he stood as the Imam of the Jamaat. So baki ke jo nabi the to unke piche khade the. So that is another concept about this. So whatever the case be, it is important that Masjid al-Aqsa as well as the rock on which Prophet was standing, both are important historically and Islamically. Some other commentaries are the Fasir, also suggests that during the course of this journey, Prophet was also shown glimpses of Jannah and glimpses of Jahannam. That is Jannah and Jannah of Paradise and Jahannam, Hell respectively. Now when we talk about the Jannah, now I am not saying Jannah, I am saying Jannah. the word gender needs some further explanation. And I think what I will explain just now about gender, that might help some of our students to understand what is Jannah and why Jannah is called Jannat. So actually the Jannah is like this. It ends with a very different type of hay, which has got two dots. So this hay is a very peculiar kind of hay with two dots at top. Now because of these two dots at top, sometimes it is pronounced as Jannat. So the word Jannat is derived actually from Jannah because of this kind of hay. This kind of hay is like this hay sound like te, and this hay also sound like te. And then we have hay like this and hay like this and hay like this. So this hay becomes quite confusing in the study of scripts which are written in Arabic languages. But then we say that zakat, because of this hay, it became zakat in Urdu or Persian. Bidda, it became bidat because of this hay at the end. And the sharia became shariat, and izza became izzat because of this hay. So ye humne apni taraf se khud hi kar liya. Yeah, it is a transformation which takes place when we are translating from one languages to the other languages. So ye is tarah ye changes aa gayi, but the actual words are like this: zaka, not zakat, zaka; bidda, not bidat; and sharia, and then izza, and so things like this. So this is very important to understand. But when this hay occurs at the end and the word end at the, then it sounds like hay. But if the same word is connected in the with the following word, then it sounds like te. So this is very naughty kind, naughty type of hay, or te, naughty type of hay and te. So if agar jud jaye to fir te ki awaaz aati hai, na jude to hay ki awaaz aati hai. For example, if it's Juma, it is Juma. But if it's Jumatul Veda, then it sounds like te. And similarly, Rahma and Rahmatul Alameen. So now here it sounds like te. Alone, it doesn't sound like te. This is very important thing. When we are reading Quran or when we're reading other scripts in Arabic language, we have to be very careful in understanding this. Now, this te, which is with two dots, was also used as a period or full stop. Gradually, it's two dots, disappeared, and he also changed into an absolute circle like this. Now used at the end of every ayah in Quran. So ye jo daira sa nazar aata hai hum apne har ayah ke end mein, it is the transformation of this he into the circle. So this is very important to understand the metamorphosis of this he from this shape to this shape in Quran. Coming back to the journey of the Prophet, and these show you some of the pictures. The Prophet is traveling upward to the heavens, and these steps indicate his journey of ascension, that he is going up and up and up. And these miniatures, of course, show some Chinese influences also. Another picture, the Prophet is riding the horse, which is known as the Burak. And then the journey is continuing, and you see the concept of Noor coming out of the Prophet's body. That is the aspect of the Noor. Noor is also a kind of light. Yet another picture with the Chinese clouds and so on. And then as I said, the Prophet was taken to Jannah as well as Jahannam, apparently, to show him what is happening inside these two places. How was the Jannah looking, and how was the Jannah looking? And the Jannah was looking like this. There's a beautiful garden, and the river is flowing, and there is flowers and fruit, etc., etc. Not very well described. Itne acha kuch nama naksha to pesh nahi kiya Jannat ka is miniature mein. But nevertheless, the artist thought it is like this. So, but we have the image of Jannah much more, more full of beauties, and much more with the elegance of life, not described in this miniature. This is another picture of Jannah, as Prophet is visiting the Jannah in this picture, and then you can see the houris and everything else. And so the most important thing is that they are chirping birds, and then the fruit trees, and the blossoms of the trees, etc., etc. This is another picture of the Jannat or the Jannah, and then the Prophet visiting it. And then the glimpses of the hell. The people are burning in the hell, and the Prophet is here looking at this. And in this case, people are burning in the hell. and the shaitan is enjoying the event of the burning of the people in the hell. And these, whatever they are, angels or whatever they are, they are persecuting the people. The hot water is being given to them to drink in the hell. So how long people can live in fire? There's another question. If you come in the fire, then you will be finished with the fire. That will be the end of life. But in this case, you will only experience the torture which you feel when you are burning in fire. But your life will not end. So the life will be eternal, and the burning in the fire will also be eternal if you happen to be in hell. That's another. Another picture of the same hell again. People are burning there, and then the devil is here enjoying the picture. Yet another picture indicating what is happening inside. This picture you already seen, but this is a detail of that. So hot water is being given to these people to drink. So many pictures are shown, but surprisingly, in Mirajnam, most of the copies of Mirajnam, more focus is on the description of hell rather than the description of paradise. Some pictures are being repeated here.